I'm Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences, CAUSES. Welcome. The University of the District of Columbia is the only public land-grant university in Washington, D.C., and the only urban land-grant university in the United States. Our focus is on the urban landscape and how we can make cities healthier and more sustainable so that the people who live here can be healthier and have a better future. Cities are now home to 80% of all people living in the United States. And worldwide, almost 60% of the population lives in cities. Cities are dense, busy spaces, and they're also spaces that consume an awful lot of natural resources and create an awful lot of emissions and waste. Computer scientists and IT specialists are important partners in the development of solutions for effective management of natural resources, emissions, and waste. With me on this edition of CAUSES is Dr. Byunggu Yu, Professor of Computer Science here at the University of the District of Columbia. Dr. Yu specializes in big data and the Internet of Things, and he is also an inventor with a special interest in urban agriculture. Welcome, Dr. Yu. So tell me, agriculture, urban sustainability, how does a computer scientist develop an interest in agriculture?
Oh, that's a natural challenge. It's when, as you said, more than 80% of the whole population are concentrated in urban areas, we have a lot of challenges to deal with. Mm-hmm. And environmental challenges and the food distribution challenges mm-hmm. are grand challenges, and the technology can make its own contribution to the whole challenge so that we can together address these challenges in a more systematic way.
So when people talk about the big data and the Internet of Things, what exactly does it mean?
Oh, big data is about large data, of course.
Okay. And a lot of data?
Is a that? Lot of data, uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. More precisely, in computer science, mm-hmm. We talk about three different types of big data. Mm-hmm. One is huge volume data. Mm-hmm. That, of course, qualifies a big data. Mm-hmm. And another type is high velocity data. That is stream type data, that is constantly coming in type data.
Okay.
Very simple example is our everyday application is Netflix or Amazon Prime movies. Mm-hmm. So these movie data are sort of high velocity data. It's stream data continuously flowing. The total amount of data is huge, mm-hmm. Although at each point in time it's just a frame. Mm-hmm. When we combine all these frames, it becomes a whole lot of data. Mm-hmm. The third different, third type big data is a wide variety of data. Mm-hmm. So data is normally structured in our system so that we can efficiently deal with, analyze, and process data. When we have a lot of different types of data mm-hmm. from all different sources, then that a wide variety of data becomes a challenging aspect of data processing. Mm-hmm. So we try to figure out how we can properly deal with these three different types of big data.
Wow. So it seems to me that in food production, some of the things that we collaborate on, really all three of them apply.
Oh, it? Yeah, absolutely. That's what I found over the past couple of years.
Yes.
While working in our projects related to urban food challenges.
Mm-hmm. So give us some examples. I mean, you've developed some really, really interesting technology for us. And, you know, as a land-grant university, ever so often we get some grant funding from the USDA, and you actually received a startup grant from us, a research grant, to develop a sensor ball. So tell us what that is.
So I took
you
the sensor bowl with me
yes.
today.
Okay.
This is our sensor bowl. Mm-hmm. And this is also sponsored by National Science Foundation. Mm-hmm. Related to big data and Internet of Things that you properly identified in the beginning, it's all about how we apply knowledge. Mm-hmm. So a recent study published in top-tier peer-reviewed journal written by a joint research team from College Park and Johns Hopkins mm-hmm. Identified a key to success in urban food production
uh-huh.
challenge. That is knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Of course.
How do we distribute knowledge? How do we gain it? And then right. how do we properly distribute it? Yes.
Right.
Absolutely.
So I personally think any advance in technology, mm-hmm. given a challenge, must go through four distinct phases. Mm-hmm. to reach some mature stage in its growth. Mm-hmm. The first one is discovery of knowledge.
Yeah.
And the second phase is application of knowledge mm-hmm. To a practical part of yeah. the challenge. And the third phase is integration of the application mm-hmm. In the system mm-hmm. so that the application becomes an integral part mm-hmm. of the whole system. Mm-hmm. The last part is, of course, education. Mm-hmm. When you have an integral permanent component created, we need to educate people so that we maintain and operate mm-hmm. The system. So we have these four different phases, and the key to success, of course, is knowledge, but to realize the knowledge,
yeah.
we need application and integration and education.
Yeah. And that's, of course, the passion we share for that
absolutely.
Applied work of really trying to find solutions
right.
for real-life problems, right?
Right.
Because
that's
if the knowledge, yeah, if the knowledge just sits on a shelf somewhere, then what good is it?
Right. We need the enablers.
Yes, absolutely.
To, fundamental driving force.
So tell us what we see here. What is the sensor ball?
Right. So, urban agriculture, mm-hmm. Food production, and this entire hub system. Including distribution and all this, of course, not my area of expertise. I'm a computer scientist.
That's why collaborations are important.
Right, so the first thing I did mm-hmm. was learning about all this,
yeah.
the domain knowledge, the urban agriculture food production system. Mm-hmm. And I learned aquaponics,
yeah.
high intensity food production system from causes,
yes.
and was excited about that. I started reading some articles mm-hmm. and some research reported that operation of high intensity food production, high tech food production system require high levels of knowledge. Okay. To properly apply knowledge, we need data collection. Mm-hmm. We need data to make proper decision based on knowledge. Mm-hmm. And then we need labor mm-hmm. to carry out the required operational tasks.
Yeah.
That's the optimization of this high-tech, highly sensitive, complicated system. Mm-hmm. The first thing that we try to focus on is data collection mm-hmm. challenge. Mm-hmm. And this sensor ball is designed to collect data from aquaponics, hydroponics, aquaculture systems, 24/7.
24/7.
Yes.
So if we can't observe it, which of course we do, right? We walk in the greenhouse and just, to just fill in a little bit of information here. What aquaponics means is we have fish tanks, and we grow fish in those tanks. And as we raise the fish, they do what they do. And the fish excrements becomes the fertilizer for plant beds that are attached to that. Now, to make things a little bit more complicated, nitrogen is of course an important source for plant growth, and all fertilizer contains nitrogen, but it, makes it a little complicated because it's not the right form of nitrogen for most plants to be able to deal with it, so we need to transform it. So that means we have to measure a lot of things. We have to measure dissolved oxygen, we have to measure pH, we have to measure temperature, we have to measure nitrogen and phosphorus and whatever else in the systems. And so this is how we started working together, right, a few years ago, to say, can you help us? Because for any person who wants to successfully run such an aquaponic system, and especially with our urban populations, a lot of people are not really accustomed to food production in the urban space. And so, wow, very challenging for any one person to keep, or even a group of people, right, to keep track of all that data. And as it usually goes, you know, you measure it, you do the testing, you take your samples in the morning and you take your samples in the evening, some kind of routine that you set up for testing, but stuff happens in between. And this is, it never happens just when you test it. It always happens at a very inopportune time, on the weekends, in the middle of the night, or whatever. And so this is why this was such an intriguing opportunity for me to approach you to see, you know, can we work together on this? Because this thing collects data, as you said, 24/7. You don't need a person there.
Right. And decision making and operating tasks can be properly managed in real time. Mm-hmm. And drastically reducing this catastrophic or disastrous errors that we can potentially have, which can result in really total loss in high-tech food production system.
You could have a lot of dead fish, right, if you don't notice in time.
It will be really a big loss.
So this will be a great help in that. So tell me, what are these legs about?
Yes, so this bowl is designed along the nutrient flow in the system as you briefed about, and it's related to fish growth environment and nitrogen cycle in the system. It has 9 sensors.
Wow.
Basically the top part, this shiny metal, is temperature sensor.
Oh, yeah.
It measures air temperature. And we have another temperature sensor on the bottom, which measures water temperature. This dome-shaped device at the center on the bottom is a turbidity sensor that measures the transparency of water. And then these legs are basically, many of them are ion selective sensors measuring chemical molecules. Those include nitrogen, ammonium, nitrite, nitrate, pH, and dissolved oxygen.
Everything you need, really.
Yes, and we can add more if you need more.
Okay. And it floats, right?
Yes.
You can just drop it in the fish tanks and it floats in the water, or if you have channels where your plants grow and the water is flowing in there, you could put one in there too.
Yes, this is watertight, so we can throw this into any water body.
So then once these little legs and so forth take up all the data, then what happens?
Oh, this one has a very small computer inside. It's tightly sealed.
Okay.
And the computer has 3 different communication technologies attached. One is, of course, wired communication. There are 2 different types of wireless communication technologies inside. One is Wi-Fi communication technology. That technology that we use every day to connect our laptop to the internet.
Yeah.
Or cell phone to the internet sometimes. And it also has a cellular communication technology embedded.
Wow.
So that cellular communication technology is what our cellular phones are relying on to be connected.
So you have 3 different ways of transmitting the data from the sensor ball to what, a computer or receiver?
To the internet.
To the internet.
And eventually reaching our data solver.
Uh-huh. And so then in the data software, that's where you can program and say, not enough oxygen.
Yes, decision making in real time, aggregation and analysis, visual analytics, all this big data related processing.
So is that what people mean by the Internet of Things?
Internet of Things basically mean many devices connected to the internet and actively participating in the data flow. So traditionally, decades ago, most players in the internet were human users.
Yeah.
So we use desktop computers or laptop computers to do something on these computers. Mm-hmm. Then data flow is generated. Mm-hmm. But nowadays, there are so many sensors and more automated devices that actively generate data flow in the internet. Mm-hmm. So that makes Internet of Things.
Mm-hmm. Like this one, picking up all that information and transmitting it.
Yes. So big data challenges all related. High velocity data, this stream data produced by sensor devices constantly. That's big data. Wide variety of data. There are so many different types of sensors and data generating devices.
You discovered a lot of interesting things as you started working with us in agriculture. And of course, one of the things is that, you know, nature is tricky.
Absolutely.
Of course, we as agricultural scientists knew that this is not a lab science. In a lab science, you have a very controlled environment. You know what's in your space, what your moving pieces are. But in agricultural science, when you are in the outdoors, or even in a greenhouse, there are a lot of things that are less controllable. So tell us about that, because I thought that was so interesting, and you discovered some of this when you started working on a camera.
Yes, that's another project that I'm delighted to introduce today. It is quite fascinating. Another research area of mine is cybersecurity.
Yes.
And we develop a lot of techniques to deal with these intrusions and threats and attacks that occur in cyberspace. Cyberspace is internet and all these connected devices. They comprise this virtual world called cyberspace. And as we have more devices connected to the space, more people spend more time on these devices, the boundary between cyberspace and physical space is becoming weakening every day. So I thought maybe the technique, some of my techniques in cyberspace could be applied to physical space. And one of such techniques is anomaly detection. So in cybersecurity, when we try to detect attacks or threats, there are two different types of attacks. One is known attack. The other type is unknown attack or zero-day attack. Known attack is what we typically deal with using this internet security software or firewall programs that detect known signature of known attacks and do some proper remediation action on these individual attacks. The other type is rather challenging. It's unknown attack. How do we detect something that we don't know about?
Never seen before.
Right. So that's anomaly detection technique. And we developed something quite efficient algorithm that can detect denial of service there's attacks that disable bank system, mm-hmm. disable web services, so that we cannot use web services.
Yeah.
And that's quite a challenging type of attack. And our technique worked very well. So I decided to apply that technique to our more physical world related product.
Uh-huh.
That is this. This is smart camera, and we embedded our cybersecurity anomaly detection technique inside this small camera.
Wow.
So what this camera does is it's watching what it sees,
mm-hmm.
and it keeps learning about the input video. Mm-hmm. When there is something strange that it has never observed mm-hmm. before, it will start recording. Mm-hmm. And the recorded video is transmitted to our data server
mm-hmm.
Over the internet. It worked wonderfully. We were actually amazed how well it works in our controlled environment, which is inside our building,
yeah.
a hallway,
yeah.
where when there's no one, it's a static view.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing really changing much.
Mm-hmm.
But, when there are some people moving around, of course, there are a lot of motion at various degree. It worked really well. So then when I install our sensor ball at the farm,
yes.
I thought maybe there should be a camera.
Yeah.
Two reasons. One, there could be something that's not detected by our sensor ball, like
mm-hmm.
When the fish tank collapsed,
mm-hmm.
when the roof is flown away,
yes.
When the structure collapsed, that
yeah.
kind of thing is not, the sensor ball is not designed to detect that
yeah.
kind of thing. So camera might be a good backup system.
Mm-hmm.
And then we were surprised again. Because the camera was recording everything.
So instead of people walking down the hallway, now you had fish tanks and ripples on the water.
Right.
And all kinds of disruptions that
exactly.
initially
mm-hmm.
the camera didn't know how to process all that motion that happens in nature. Even when you don't detect it, but the camera has this ability to be really fine-tuned on any kind of motion.
Yes, exactly, that's the point. The camera tries its best to learn about everything it sees.
Yeah.
But it's too much. We,
yeah.
we use this term called entropy.
Entropy.
Entropy in physics is more related to energy
yeah.
Transfer in physics, a physical environment. In computer science, we call Shannon entropy.
Mm-hmm.
When we try to talk about how various the problem that we are dealing with
mm-hmm.
is. So the whole dynamics of the environment
mm-hmm.
shows a lot more variety,
mm-hmm.
this high entropy in our terminology,
yeah.
compared to our controlled environment.
Mm-hmm.
So the camera was not able to learn everything that it need to learn
mm-hmm.
during a finite time period.
Mm-hmm.
So when it reaches upper limit mm-hmm. of its learning capacity, it start reporting everything.
So it's almost like an overload situation.
Yeah.
Too much information streaming, and
right.
then it doesn't know how to process.
Right.
It's sort of like with people too, right? We have information overload and we say, oh, enough, right?
Actually, that's a proper term, information overload.
Yeah.
Right.
So how did you solve it?
Our approach is now a two-phase approach.
Mm-hmm.
So the first phase is camera processing phase. So this camera first apply a camera level filter to filter out unnecessary background motion as much as it can. Mm-hmm. Now, the rest of the data is processed on the cloud. Mm-hmm. Because the cloud server has more processing power,
okay,
more storage space, it can do more, a lot more than what camera can do, mm-hmm, at every fraction of time.
So things like, for example, the ripples on the water, which is almost unavoidable when you do aquaponics, that would be filtered out?
Actually, we have some patented technique, mm-hmm, that can filter out ripples on water. That was the first challenge that we had to address. The rest of the challenge is more related to this irregular sway motion of plants inside, mm-hmm, aquaponics, hydroponics systems. Mm. And that's more challenging to filter out because of the location uncertainty of motion.
Oh,
vectors.
Interesting. So the ripples are more sort of an ongoing occurrence. Mm-hmm. But the motion of the plants in the plant beds is more unpredictable.
Right.
Interesting.
So ripples are confined by the boundary of the water tank.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the camera can quickly learn about it.
Yes. Huh. And then you have to monitor the whole rest of the greenhouse.
Right.
Using a different algorithm to process that?
Yes. We apply sophisticated motion analysis on our cloud system to filter out the rest of the motion. One challenge remaining though.
Which is?
Bugs.
Ah, bugs, yes.
Bugs are really hard to
insects.
Filter out.
Mm-hmm. So they're even more unpredictable.
Yes, uh-huh. So we are still working on that mm-hmm, remaining problem, mm-hmm, on this project.
But you've made huge progress.
It's been some noticeable progress, mm-hmm, over a period of 12 months, mm-hmm, and this one is a lot more than our original cybersecurity algorithm now.
Mm-hmm. It looks pretty slick too,
yes.
I have to say. It
actually
looks pretty
we
elegant.
Painted the housing.
You did? Okay. So you're ready to go to market with your new technology?
Yeah, this one is actually very meaningful in terms of commercialization, and it may look like some normal security camera housing, but inside is completely different.
My guest today has been Dr. Byunggu Yu, Professor of Computer Science here at the University of the District of Columbia. Dr. Yu works with researchers in our College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences to improve the quality of life and economic opportunity for residents in the District of Columbia by making our city a healthier, greener, and more resilient city. We share our research and knowledge, not only with our students in classrooms and laboratories, but with the public through our land grant programs. So you will find causes, faculty, and staff in schools, churches, community centers, and at farmers markets in every ward of the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit us at www.udc.edu/causes. Thank you for joining me on Causes, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. I am Sabine O'Hara. See you next time on Causes.